Welcome to Creative Development with IFC. I'm Makhtar Diop, Managing Director of the International Finance Corporation. Today, I'm joined by a very special guest, Nadia Nadim. Born in Afghanistan, Nadia, her mother and four sisters, arrived in Denmark as refugees when she was just 12 years old. Since then, she has become a top-tier international player, playing for teams like Manchester City, Paris Saint-Germain, AC Milan, and the Danish national women team. Off the field, Nadia is equally impressive. She has mastered 9 languages, has qualified as a doctor specializing in reconstructive surgery, and is a UNESCO champion for girls and women education. Nadia, it's a huge pleasure to have you here on our podcast. What you've done is just incredible as a human being. How did it start? Being a top player, moving from Afghanistan, being a medical doctor. Take us a little bit through that journey.
First and foremost, thanks for having me. I'm very excited. And regarding to your question, well, I would say it started when I was born. I was born in Afghanistan, but unfortunately, because of war and because of my father's position in the Afghan army, he was executed, leaving our family in a very harsh situation, which made us flee Afghanistan, and we found safety in my adopted country, Denmark. And I would say, when it comes to football, I always say it's fate, because I was in a refugee camp in Denmark, and next to us was these amazing football fields. And then that's the first time where I saw girls play football. You know, being born in Afghanistan, being a girl with culture, tradition, religion playing a huge role in your upbringing. There's few things you're allowed to do and so many things you're not supposed to do. And playing sports was definitely not one of those things I was allowed or supposed to do. But for me, when you're young, and I was very grateful to have a mother who was very educated, and she never found anything wrong in girls playing or attending sport. And also, again, I feel fortunate to have been, in a country like Denmark, where the differences between what girls and boys can do is not that big. Girls play sports, boys play sports. So for me, at the beginning, I would say tough, because you don't really know the culture, you don't know the people, you're really, really new in all of it, and then a bit scared because you're a kid. But I felt, as soon as I had the courage to take the first step towards the football field, I feel everyone around me, even though they didn't know me and we didn't speak the same language or look like each other, they opened their arms. And I thought that was like a beautiful thing. And I think that's also one of the reasons I love football so much, because it's such an international communication tool. You can communicate even though you don't really speak the language. It eased me in Denmark. I felt I belonged quite fast, to be honest.
It's quite impressive, Nadia. You were in Paris Saint-Germain, you were in AC Milan. And it's quite interesting that you are able to mix that very high level career with academic achievement. How were you able to organize your day?
I would say, where there's will, there's a way. I really wanted to do both. For me, football has always been my passion. It's something that I really love, and I'm very, very, very competitive. So I always want to do my best. I want to be the best. So I think that's the reason I've, played for some of the best teams in the world. You said it, Manchester City, Paris Saint-Germain, Portland Thorns, and now in AC Milan. And I've always over 100 caps for a Danish national team. It's because of that inner motivation to want to learn and grow. But I also knew from very early age, and again, that's because of my mother, the power of education. I know education is the most important thing that we have in the world. It gives you a voice. It makes you understand your surroundings. So when I was around, 14, 15 years old, it's not enough for me. I want to also contribute in a different way. And as a doctor, I felt that I could be in positions where I could have a direct impact on people's lives. I do understand how it feels to be on the other side and receiving help. So hence my passion to give back and make a difference in the world.
Yeah, but you're talking about it as if it was an easy thing to do. I do my medicine degree. I have 100 caps. You go to Milan. It's just a matter of will. I think that it's more than that. It's a lot of talent, but also some things which is quite impressive. Just to remind people, as a level that Nadia was playing, she has two or three trainings a day. She's on the road all the time. The team is getting together to prepare for the European Cup, the World Cup, and she managed to be a medical doctor while doing that. So you have something special and quite unique in that regard.
Thank you. Thank you. That's really kind of you. You know, yes, I do. I do believe I have certain talent, you know, but also I do believe in hard work. I think hard work is underrated or underestimated. I know these are two big professions that required a lot of my time. And for me, I was really like almost obsessed of making this work. And it's definitely not been easy. I'll be honest with you. There's been times where, you know, especially close to my exams, where time-wise, I didn't have enough time to get everything working. But again, you know, I put my head down and I tried to concentrate and focus on why I was doing this, what was my motivation. And at the end of the day, you know, if your passion and your heart is there and you're willing to grind it out, it'll take you places. And for me, you know, because of my background, seeing what I've seen and experienced as a young age, it built this character in me. And I want to be in a position where, first of all, I will never want to go back to those feelings and emotions I had as a kid, because you're so hopeless. And I think that's probably my biggest engine, biggest drive, that I don't want to be in a position where I don't have the power over my own life. I don't decide what I have to do. So I think that's probably, yeah, been the biggest factor for me, but also for my siblings who have actually accomplished quite amazing things as well.
Your passion also, I think, inspired you in a sense, and your history. Reconstructive surgery is at the cross of where you're coming from, because a lot of refugees have been suffering from traumas which require reconstructive surgery, but also players often need to have reconstructive surgery during their professional career. So is it where your passion for reconstructive surgery is coming?
Yeah, so I think it's because of my character, to be honest. And I felt that would fit my character, my personality the best. I weren't challenged. And I felt reconstructive plastic surgery will give you that freedom, that creativity, where you have to find ways to try to fix this problem. It's not going to be only one way to do it. It really excites me to be in the operation room. I get the same feelings when if you scored a goal, the adrenaline and the, I won't say power, but the responsibility that you have in your hand. It's quite unique and something that I really enjoy.
Both professions require really a lot of teamwork. Basic is teamwork. You have all a full team working with you when you are a surgeon. And when you are a striker or a member of the team, it's okay, you need also to rely on your colleagues and your teammates. How the need for teamwork in sports have helped you in your professional career as a medical doctor?
You said it yourself, there's no one in the world who can win a game alone. No one, no matter who you are, Messi, Ronaldo, the biggest of the biggest, you need to have support. You need to be on the same page. And I love that part of this teamwork that you can then take out from anywhere in your life. So for me, I think everything that I've learned on the football field is something that I can take with me in every aspect of my life. If it's in the hospital, if it's with my family, it's something that you learn to respect, you learn to understand, even though you might have differences, because at the end of the day, this overall goal, that's where we need to go. And then if all of us are not on the same page, it's not going to work. So definitely something that I've been taking with me, you know, and I love that aspect of the game. I think, you know, you can always see everyone has a role. I like to be the one, I wouldn't say, in charge. I like to lead because, again, it comes down to responsibility. I like to have that extra responsibility. So it's a beautiful thing. And that's something that I've used a lot everywhere, actually, not only in medicine and football, every aspect of my life.
You are an ambassador at UNESCO. You are working with UNESCO on women and education. And you have a big emphasis on STEM because of your profession, of what you have done. If today in this current world, you were to talk to people who have the same passion as yours, and both on STEM, sports, and so forth, what you would be telling them that to be aware of, that maybe you are not aware of when you are entering this complex and challenging journey? What would be the two words of advice that you would be giving to young women
I would say, first and foremost, especially if you are a woman, a girl, as I said, all humans are always put in boxes. Certain boxes are bigger than others. And depending on where you come from, those boxes vary in size, as I said. So if you were born in Afghanistan, your box is quite small. If you're born parts of Africa, South America, again, and depending if you're a girl, that box is really tiny. So you're supposed to, at least that's what the world tells you, to stay in your box and do everything in there. But for me, in reality, there's no box. You should do whatever you want to and you think you can do. Nothing comes easy. You have to work really hard with it. You're going to meet people again who say, no, you're not supposed to get out of that box. What you're doing is wrong. There's going to be a lot of people. But at the end of the day, don't listen to them. Listen to your own heart, your own passion. You can do whatever you want to do. I know it sounds like a cliche, but that is the reality. There's no secret to it. Follow your heart. And then, of course, nothing comes by itself. You have to work harder than anyone else and believe that you are capable of doing it.
That's fantastic. I was lucky to attend the last Women Football World Cup in Australia and New Zealand. It was just amazing atmosphere. It was just fantastic. And to see how women football now has taken another dimension. And it's interesting because a year later, you see the WNBA, women basketball, now is taking a new dimension in the US. At the heart of the conversation is wages, salaries paid to professional players, conditions. You know, you learn that the national team of country X is not having the same facilities as the national team of the male national team in the same countries. You start realizing that you are working in much harder conditions. You start realizing that the stadiums are much smaller and they are not at the standard, and so forth. So how do you see the trajectory now that we have this kind of big push to put this issue at the table and try to address them in the right way?
Yeah, indeed. You know, women's football has grown a lot. It's amazing to be a part of it, amazing to see. And you know, I would say it's on time that people, you know, open their eyes and see that there's like a huge potential in every aspect. You know, you investing wise, there's like a huge market that not a lot of people have tapped into it, but slowly happening. Really nice to see. When it comes to salary, then the salary gap there is between male and female players. Yeah, still really long way to go, but I'm optimistic. I hope in the future we're going to, you know, get closer. I don't know ever if we're going to have the same, salaries. I doubt it, but just getting closer, that'll be amazing as well, because at the end of the day, you should get paid for your efforts and what you put in. My biggest dream is that, you know, it's not only 4 or 5 countries who are getting there, you know, getting closer, better facilities, abundance, but actually also the countries where you don't hear about them, the ones that might not attend the World Cup, that those girls, it's not about the money, it's about the access, that they are given the same opportunities. They're given the same chance to do something with their talents, to attend sports. Because let's face it, there's probably like 5, 6, 7 countries in the world right now in women's game where you see, okay, from federation side and from the fans, they have the support, the media's behind them, and it's, you know, it's growing and it's beautiful to watch. But a lot of parts of the world, the girls don't even know football exists. And that's, you know, one of my missions in life, you know, to bring this beautiful game places where kids don't have it, because it is a powerful tool. You can learn so much about it, but also, who knows, maybe the kids in Afghanistan, if all of them were given a chance, you'll have more football players from there. If kids from, you know, Somalia also was given the chance, you'll have amazing players. At the end of the day, for me, it's all about access. And then I know there's a lot of people work on it, and my hope is that, you know, women's games keep growing and that we'll have more female players to make this game even better than it is today.
And Nadia, for me, I think that nobody better than you to really help on that message, because you have such a role model and an inspiration for people like me. Looking what you have done is just amazing for me. And I feel sure that you'll be surprised how you could impact, and you will be impacting a lot of women in some places when they hear you talking. I see that in some developing countries and less advanced countries, which are now becoming, you know, more important in the football scene. Like I take my country, Senegal, I've been making a lot of progress in football. I see now more and more academies which are including women. They had very strong academies for men, but now they start having academies for women. And I'm sure that all these young girls who are now looking at a professional career will be delighted to hear from you. And we need to work on it to make sure that you could talk to them. I understand it's very easy to you, but I understand you speak all languages in the world, or nearly. So you can talk to people in many languages and share that experience of yours. And I would love to see how we can work with UNESCO, maybe with you, and have your voice, because I think there is nothing more powerful than your experience in terms of leadership for women, because for me, leadership is not an abstract word. It's exactly the kind of things that you have done.
Thank you. That's very kind of you. And yes, I do agree. I think, you know, it's amazing to see the growth of football also, as you said, globally. And then you spoke about leadership, female leadership. I always say girls who play football become great leaders. And I would love to, you know, be there any time you guys need me. We have to unite to try to make an impact everywhere we can.
And even don't realize how true it is what you said. As a former prime minister of Senegal, a woman, played soccer. I was meeting with some of my team staff, and I realized that two of my colleagues played at a very high level in football in their countries. And more recently, I was at our board, and the Scandinavian representative was also a member of the national team of our own country. So more you talk to people and learn about their experience and life, you realize that you know, they have been playing a sport at a high level, and that helped a lot in their leadership role. So thank you for being that role model. Maybe if I can have some word of advice for what institution like ours, IFC, which is financing the private sector in developing countries, can do to help on the gender side. You talk about leadership is becoming part of our scorecard. We are trying to practice it and do it in boards, in companies, to see the number of women we are represented in boards, the number of women we are leading companies. But any things that you think that you can do on our space based on your experience?
That's amazing. You know, the fact that you're asking, that's already like a big thing, you know. So for me, I believe in the power of opportunity, and I believe in equal opportunity. I don't believe only given a chance because you're gender. No, I wanted to be given a chance because of my qualities. And I think of my experience as part of the world where that's not the case, just because you are a woman, you're not supposed to do certain things that I explained earlier. So just the fact that you are trying to like open the doors and say, hey, listen, these are the positions that we offer for male and female, I think that's a big start. And of course, you know, having strong role models in those positions, that's, as humans, we get inspired, we look up, we try to relate to people who've done it before, because until then, we don't really believe in it until it's done. So having more leaders, more women in any sector, that's going to kind of influence the coming generation. I think that's probably the best way to create change. For me, I do believe that you can do a lot in the groundwork, but at the end of the day, if you really want to have a huge impact, is where you have the power, is those people have to have the right point of view, have to have the right attitude towards, and really wanted to have that change, you know. So I think you're already on the right track.
I would love to partner with you and, you know, having your voice added to the conversation on leadership, because you are bringing a lot of dimensions to my view, sports, women in STEM, all those messages will be very important in helping us shaping a leadership experience. So I will be honored and delighted to partner with you on that.
Thank you. Yes, 100%. As we mentioned, you know, something we know in sports, we have to work together to achieve our goals. There's no one who can make it alone. And that's why I'm always open to, you know, like people who are on the same track, have same ambitions, same goal. the more we are, the stronger voice we're going to have and the bigger impact. So just let me know where and I'll be there.
Thank you so much, Nadia. It's been a huge pleasure talking to you and getting to know you. And I'm sure that we'll be doing some more things together. And thank you for being available.